By the mid-70s, TNT9 was well established, providing a wider service to its audience and improved quality due to continuing advances in technology. But now the station faced its biggest challenge since it opened transmission in 1962. For all involved, it was again a time of high drama and excitement, with an air of expectation that echoed throughout the community. It was, of course, the change to colour television. In the months preceding C-Day, activity reached an all-time high. New equipment had to be installed and tested, at the same time maintaining the standard of on-air presentation.
It wasn't particularly difficult, it was time-consuming. More time-consuming than, say, wiring a station from scratch, because you had to keep the old station on air while you were doing it.
And how hard was that?
It was an interesting exercise. It was like playing chess to a degree. Control rooms would be physically set up in different areas while we, so we could strip out old ones, and temporary facilities would be set up.
Finally, the day arrived and TNT9 could boast more than 70% of programming being broadcast in colour. But it didn't happen without its share of headaches.
There was a complete replacement of all cameras. We had to modify the transmitters for colour, which that was a major modification. All the processing gear was rewired. In fact, the whole station was virtually rebuilt from the ground up. There was maybe one or two items of black and white equipment would have been left.
The 70s were also a period of great change in the world around us. It was a time of triumph and tragedy, war and peace, and all the while television was there, bringing the latest events into the homes of its viewers.
Well, I thought it sounded like a bomb falling, and I thought it was an earthquake.
Only a few of Darwin's 12,000 homes are believed intact. All national emergency services have swung into action.
Nothing will save the Governor General.
On January 7, 1975, Hobartians awoke to find a gaping hole in the bridge that links the city and Eastern Shore. The night before, the bulk ore carrier Lake Illawarra rammed the Tasman Bridge, demolishing two pylons and three deck spans, leaving vehicles teetering on the edge. Two cars plunged into the Derwent, along with 7,000 tonnes of concrete, which crashed onto the ship, sinking it within 3 minutes. 12 people died in the disaster, which was later blamed on human error. Today, the Lake Illawarra remains where she sank.
Light of the Olympic flame, there were victories and defeats, and there were those memorable moments that characterized the Munich Games. The outstanding personality of these 16 days was undoubtedly Mark Spitz.
And now a betting record for Australia. The first man in history, Australian keeper, to get a century in a test, and he's done it in the centennial.
Drake Tuttle's got it. That is the record. The wicket-taking test match record. Barry Gomes, put Drake Tuttle, Paul Dennis Lilly to give nearly 310 wickets in test match cricket.
Television of the 70s was in stark contrast to that of the 60s. The changing values and fashion trends were reflected in what we watched.
I did, but she said it's urgent. Something about your brother.
Rod, what about him?
Well, I don't know. She wants to speak to you.
Oh, go on then, Bev. Your brother might have dropped dead or something.
Don't you dare say that. You can say anything you like about my mother, but not about Rod.
Having reached its teen years, TV became more daring and, well, a touch risque.
Almost live from the studios of Channel 9 in Northern Tasmania, across from a revolving TV aerial, able to leave cameras in a single bound, it's the Saturday Night Show. This week featuring the Tapestry Dancers, Paul Bessel, Alice Hardy, Lucy and the Illusionist, John McNally, John Stewart, the vegetating Alan Snail, the desirable Raylene Dansbody, and the unbelievable Mick and Sid. And now, here are your hosts, James Cox and Gra Gra Goodings.
I like this one.
No, this one's for you.
Why can't I have this one?
Little boys, little balls, big boys, big balls.
First off, it is the Miracle Garden Magician. Remember, first off, if you don't use it, you will be.
Probably the most memorable night of the Saturday Night Show was when often we used to have audience participation, and one particular night, we got the audience, or asked the audience, to bring in pet frogs. We're going to have a frog race in the studio. Now, we thought we'd probably get about 10 or 15 entries. More than 200 people turned up at the studio with frogs. Little frogs, medium-sized frogs, big frogs, cane toads, you name it, they had them all. Now, we got them all lined up in the studio. The starter's gun went, and of course, the frogs went in every direction but the right one. They leapt into the audience, people were screaming, they leapt into every dark corner in the building. The RSPCA was on the phone. People were ringing up in horror because a lot of these kids who brought in their frogs who thought they were going to win when they lost got very upset and they were tearing limbs off the frogs and throwing them away. That was bad enough. But for days and in fact weeks later, frogs were turning up around the building, hopping down corridors, out of drawers. But the final straw was when a frog was found swimming around in the ladies' toilet bowl.
There was always somebody prepared to pull a prank. I can remember on one occasion the newsreader who was very serious newsreader was sitting up and one of the cameramen lit the news at the bottom of the page, and in those days they didn't have auto cue, and he started to read the news faster and faster to beat the flames that were eating up his news.
This practice goes back only 10 years or less. We had no microwave link from our Northwest Coast studios to the Launceston studios in those days, so the only way of getting material to Launceston from Devonport or Burnie was to flag down a motorist on the Bass Highway, normally at some point, and ask them would they kindly take the tape to Launceston at a strategic drop-off point. We used to use about half a dozen different locations in Launceston, whichever was most convenient for that particular driver, and they would drop the tape off. It sounds unbelievable, and it would then be edited in the Launceston studios. The most amazing thing about it is, in all the years it happened, we only ever lost one tape, so it says something about the basic honesty of people you've never even met before.
I know. Don't tell me. You're a Sagittarian, right?
No.
What are you?
A lesbian.
After the break, we'll look at television through the 80s, the technology, the professionalism, and big money of a new era in broadcasting. Television had become a big money business, requiring more professional standards in programming and presentation than in previous decades. Computer technology had also made a valuable contribution to the industry. Video cameras replaced film cameras, and with the advent of satellite communication, television became an instant medium, drastically increasing the speed at which information and pictures could be relayed. For the first time, viewers could see events as they happened via satellite. The world became a smaller place. We were no longer isolated from the realities that existed on other parts of planet Earth.
Well, it sounds unbelievable to say this in 1992, but it's only 15 years ago that people in Tasmania were getting day-old news from the rest of the Australian mainland. We used to actually physically fly the stories across on tapes from a Melbourne channel and play them here the next night. It sounds unbelievable now, but that used to be a common practice. People just won't accept that now. They expect to see events on the day they happen, and quite often, as we saw with the Gulf War last year, as they happen. I mean, I can't ever think of a war that was actually telecast live into people's lounge rooms.
The parents of Azaria Chamberlain have now left Ayers Rock to return to their Mount Isa Seventh-day Adventist church, and they've accepted that their 10-week-old baby is probably dead.
I just yelled. There wasn't time to go and tell people. I just yelled out, has anyone got a torch? Dingo's got my baby.
Stay in and give us the money. There are people dying now.
From the beginning, there were no guarantees that the largest music event in history with the largest television audience ever would be an unqualified success in raising money for starving people in Africa.
In the 1980s, one subject permeated the news. Debate on the environment began with a plan to dam the Franklin River. In Hobart, the No Dams rally was Tasmania's biggest, attracting up to 20,000. The campaign launched one of Australia's best-known conservationists. Dr. Bob Brown again joined protesters in the mid-80s when the focus turned to forestry. At the end of the decade, another forestry issue would cost the Liberals' government. The Green Independents took their fight against a new Northwest pulp mill to the polls, winning 5 seats and the balance of power.
Thank you.
Or has he?
And Alan Jones takes that Union Jack to win the Caesars Palace Grand Prix, the World Championship decider.
Sweeps and victory for Australia by 9 wickets, 4 runs to David Boone.
Here she comes, there's the committee vessel. Yeah,
there it is.
It was also a time of change for TNT 9. After many years under the umbrella of ENT, Tricom Corporation, now the Southern Cross Broadcasting Group, took over the reins. While the takeover didn't affect overall staffing, operation or programming policies of the station, Tasmanian television did have a new face.
I think after such a long period of ownership where TNT was really the new flagship of the ENT company, it was quite an upheaval for the people that worked at TNT, particularly the long-termers. And when that happened in May 1988, I think there was a lot of uncertainty at the station, a lot of uncertainty by the staff towards the new owners. But that was almost 4 years ago now, in fact, almost exactly 4 years ago. And I don't think there's any doubt that the station has settled down quite quickly. And I think the people that are working here and the new employees that are working under new ownership are more than happy with the new arrangements.
Over the years, there have been many changes in professionalism, technology and the staff in front of and behind the camera. But one thing hasn't changed, the commitment to quality viewing for the region's audience.
Why does it have to be me?
Because you drive a King's Wood.
Six little ducks that I once knew. Fat ones, skinny ones, fair ones too.
Angela has a brother, a twin brother.
After the break, we look ahead to the 90s and the shape of television to come.